You're all very welcome. I'm saying that when I'm a guest here myself. Very nice to be back at PRONI and to have such an impressive panel. I'm part of the B team, I should say, so I'm speaking at 2 o'clock after the class acts have all got their trains back home. But then, of course, I'm being piped in, so that's an added bonus to that. Our first speaker then on an impressive panel of three distinguished historians of the Gallipoli campaign is Myles Dungan, which I'm sure it's a name that's familiar to a number of you. He's a historian and broadcaster with RTE in Dublin, and hosts particularly their history programme on RTE Radio 1 on Sunday evenings, which is well worth tuning into and can be downloaded by podcast. Always has a number of interesting speakers, and I've contributed myself in the past to pretty grilling questions, so that's quite an interesting programme to listen to, and we could say rather unfortunate that the BBC doesn't have an equivalent, so certainly we should highlight that. He's also a very prolific author, and there's two books that I would particularly highlight for you linked to what he's talking about today. One is Irish Voices from the Great War, and the other is They Shall Grow Not Old, Irish Soldiers and the Great War. These both came out originally in the 1990s, and I think did a lot to contribute to that reawakening of Irish interest in the First World War at that time, and both of them are bringing rather difficult sources in the RTE archives and in the Imperial War Museum, National Army Museum, to a wider audience. These are not easy places necessarily to work in yourself, so some very interesting stuff there. And these books, I think, are both available now as downloaded ebooks at a very reasonable price. I think one's coming up on Amazon for as little as £9, so certainly well worth a look. So with no more ado, I'll hand over to Myles, who's talking about the first draft of history, British journalism and the Gallipoli campaign.
Tim, thank you very much indeed. No pressure, being described as a member of the A-team. I don't think I've ever been a member of an A-team before in my life, of any description, certainly not of a sporting nature. Right, fans with typewriters, with appropriate apologies to one Eamon Dunphy. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the estimable Mr. Dunphy, but he refers to many Irish soccer journalists as fans with typewriters. I refer to many of the journalists of the First World War in the same light. And I will be discussing Gallipoli, because Gallipoli is probably the single most important event in the context of British journalism, or British stroke Australian journalism in the war. But I want to give a brief summary to begin with of the dilemma faced by the British World War I journalist in covering the war, and how most of the representatives of the profession ensconced in France and Belgium proceeded to gladden the hearts of the generals and the politicians whose war they were covering. More than a century ago, an otherwise unknown correspondent with the almost fictional name of Aeneas Sweetland Dallas, writing to a relatively obscure publication, Blackwood's Edinburgh Magazine, described newspaper journalism in a memorable phrase as fugitive literature. In other words, not a literature of still contemplation, but one of movement. In the case of World War I, I would suggest that it was more furtive than fugitive. Why do we learn far more about the true nature of World War I, the essence of World War I, from the memoirs of veterans lodged in the Imperial War Museum that Tim was talking about there, the poetry of Owen, Sassoon, Rosenberg and Gurney, the prose of Robert Graves, the songs sung in the trenches by disillusioned and cynical troops, or the post-war memoirs, and I emphasise post-war memoirs, of the journalists who were assigned to cover the conflict in the first place, than we do from reading contemporary reports from the front of the fighting. Granted, those reports often conveyed some of the atmosphere of the war, but they were generally a triumph of style over substance, and in many cases, highly imaginative, and I mean that in an entirely pejorative sense. In his magnificent examination of post-war cultural tropes, The Great War and Modern Memory, Paul Fussell has written, "The Great War reversed the idea of progress." This is true, even though World War I can be said to have ushered in the modern era. And it's certainly true of war journalism, of British war journalism, which stepped backwards into an age of strict and even more significantly acquiescent censorship, and generated a crisis of public confidence in the credibility of the news media. It was as if the huge journalistic advances of the 19th century had never happened. Journalism had been preparing for half a century for just such a challenge as the Great War. Editors in the democracies of Europe had been pushing out the boundaries of commentary and speaking truth to power for decades. In the case of the increasingly uncensorable British press since the 1850s and the Crimean War in the context of war coverage. But when it came to the most crucial event British newspapers had faced since the relaxation of the regime controlling a free press in the mid-19th century, they regressed and allowed themselves to become mouthpieces of the government and the military. Now, I distinguish here between press coverage and journalistic coverage. There is a distinction between the two. To have succumbed to strict and unyielding censorship would have been sad but understandable. But the British press, British journalists, went far beyond obeisance towards outright propaganda and lies. As Philip Knightley has put it in his superb survey of war journalism, The First Casualty, the title, by the way, comes from a quote by the American isolationist politician Senator Hiram Johnson, who said when the US entered the war in 1917, the first casualty when war comes is the truth. Knightley says, more deliberate lies were told than in any other period of history, and the whole apparatus of the state went into action to suppress the truth. Now, while I think there's an element of hyperbole there, it's axiomatic that when governments have decided that it is necessary to kill people, including their own people, in large numbers, they need to be even more closely monitored than usual, not given a patriotic fool's pardon. That, in essence, is what happened in Britain during the Great War. The Defence of the Realm Act, which governed everything in wartime Britain, from licensing hours to the throwing of rice at weddings, it was banned, began life as a short enabling act of a few paragraphs and ended up as over 650 pages of regulations, as I'm sure you know. Interestingly, one of the earliest of those regulations, this was introduced on the 1st of September 1914, read as follows. No person shall by word of mouth or in writing spread reports likely to cause disaffection or alarm among any of His Majesty's forces or among the civilian population. That is a substantial fishing net, indeed, with which to trawl in the waters of news and commentary and catch opponents of the war, conscientious objectors, or mere reporters of unwelcome fact who might wish to commit their words to newsprint. So it gave the government license, a lot of license. However, like the music industry, which was subject to similar regulation, the newspaper business, by and large, would not have chosen to cause disaffection or alarm by publishing the truth, even had it been permitted to do so, particularly in the latter stages of the war. From the 4th of August onwards, with certain exceptions to which I would refer, the British newspaper press led, cheered out, essentially, the war effort. Some pacifist or radical newspapers, many of the latter in Ireland, journals like Arthur Griffith's Sinn Féin and Connolly's The Irish Worker, did editorialise against the war and sought to discourage recruitment, but they were rapidly closed down by Anti-Dora. Almost unique among mainstream daily newspapers, the Manchester Courier, ironically owned by Lord Northcliffe, on the 4th of August, obviously pre-Dora, pre the Defence of the Realm Act, carried this full-page advertisement from the Neutrality League. Do your duty. Keep your country out of a wicked and stupid war. Small but powerful cliques are trying to rush you into it. You must destroy the plot today or it will be too late. It already was too late at that stage, and it was certainly too late for the publication of any future examples of an advertisement like that. After an initial period of skirmishing between the military and the newspapers, a time when unofficial and unauthorised correspondence did their utmost to report the facts of what was happening in the retreat from Mons and the so-called race to the sea, the military realised that supervised and regulated reportage was better than wildcat, hit and miss, and potentially negative coverage. So a deal was done, and a small number of pool reporters were given uniforms, rank, cars, accommodation, and their own censors, one of whom was C.E. Montague, a former Guardian journalist who had enlisted at the age of 47. He actually blacked, he used boot polish on his white hair to disguise the fact that he was as old as he was. He had no desire to sit at a desk gutting the copy of his former colleagues, but that was his unfortunate fate. His memoir of the war, Disenchantment, is a powerful indictment of the system that was put in place, and a system that served, as far as he was concerned, the British public very badly. I'll be invoking Montague rather a lot today. Most World War I correspondents cheerfully became staff wallahs with typewriters. It's salutary to look at the career of one of the better known and more prolific of the breed, Sir Philip Gibbs of the Daily Chronicle. The knighthood was a reward for 4 years of biting his tongue. In 1914, he operated in France, in Belgium, in much the manner of a Robert Fisk, as an independent observer going where he wasn't wanted. In other words, a reporter. He was once discovered in a war zone and warned that if he returned to France, he would be shot. However, 2 years later, his poaching days well behind him, he became a gamekeeper. In 1923, in one of his many autobiographical works, Adventures in Journalism, he was unambiguous about the Great War journalistic narrative. He wrote, "We identified ourselves absolutely with the armies in the field. We wiped out of our minds all thought of personal scoops and all temptation to write one word which would make the task of officers and men more difficult or dangerous. There was no need of censorship of our dispatches. We were our own censors." War journalism was in effect back to the status quo ante bellum. The bellum in question being Crimea, where journalists like William Russell from Tella in Dublin were loathed by the generals for telling the truth about what was going on. Gibbs contended that he was, through his often deliberately misleading reportage, trying to, quote, spare the feelings of men and women who have sons and husbands fighting in France, unquote. Now, perhaps their bitterness might have been more easily assuaged had they been told something more closely resembling the truth. He actually claimed that the truth had been reported on the first day of the Somme, quote, apart from the naked realism of horrors and losses, unquote. So, essentially, Shakespeare seen through the prism of Thomas Bodler. It was possible, given the nature of 19th century warfare as fought between professional armies, for a gulf to exist between the reality and the romantic perception of war. What Gibbs revealingly says in one of his memoirs, he calls it the heart of its adventure and romance. It was outside of the experience of most, that is, war was, and it had always been tied up with ideas of heroism, honour and sacrifice. After 1915, with millions in the uniform of Kitchener's new army, that dissonance between Victorian romanticism on the one side and industrialised slaughter on the other became more apparent. Gibbs, in another memoir, 5 Years on the Western Front, takes his own profession to task when he writes of the beginning of the war, a time when, ironically, much genuine reportage did take place, including that of Gibbs himself, against severe odds and in dangerous circumstances, but he chooses to take issue with that reportage. He wrote, "Reading the English newspapers in those early days of the war, with their atrocity mongering, their wild perversions of truth, a journalist proud of his profession must blush for shame at its degradation and insanity." Now, there's no doubt that atrocity stories, many of which, by the way, were absolutely true, as John Horne and Alan Cramer of Trinity College have illustrated, had a powerful impact on a recruitment in the early days of the war. Just as the music industry was doing its bit with songs like "Your King and Country Want You," the newspaper industry was helping augment recruitment numbers by reporting some rather wild stories brought to Britain by Belgian refugees with an axe to grind. But it was also reporting atrocities that were taking place. But it was also a time when journalists, as I said, were doing their best to report what was happening as honestly as possible. And it's interesting that Gibbs chooses to critique this early period of war coverage. Now, behind every great reporter, there is, of course, a great proprietor. According to Gibbs, newspaper proprietors like Lord Northcliffe, the Dublin-born Alfred Harmsworth, the owner of the Mail and the Times, having recently sold the Mirror to his brother Harold, later Lord Rothermere, were actually the ablest propagandists. Proprietors and editors subordinated, according to Gibbs, everything to a genuine and patriotic desire to play the game, to support the army, and to avoid any criticism or controversy which might hamper the military chiefs or demoralise the nation. Now, that's true as far as it went, and I would dispute a lot of the truth in what Gibbs has said there, but it failed to take into account also, among other things, the monstrous ego of a man like Northcliffe, who was happy to engage in criticism and controversy, and delighted in campaigns designed to, for example, discredit Kitchener, the Mail at the time having been partly responsible for his appointment in the first place. Northcliffe once wrote of Kitchener that he was purely the creation of publicity, much of this publicity emanating from his own newspapers. Northcliffe took aim at Winston Churchill and wished to force the resignation of the often indolent Prime Minister Herbert Asquith. So Northcliffe had an agenda. He had a political agenda, and I would argue to some extent he had a personal agenda in terms of his own sense of self-worth and self-aggrandisement. Northcliffe also doggedly defended the equally unimaginative, though far less indolent than Asquith, Field Marshal Haig, in both instances simply, one suspects, because he could. Haig, incidentally, according to Norman Dixon, in his study on the psychology of military incompetence, nursed a pathological fear of journalists. So, as indeed did Kitchener. Northcliffe later accepted the role of director of propaganda in the Ministry for Information, and Norman Beaverbrook, owner of the Daily Express and the London Evening Standard, became Minister for Information. Winston Churchill, although I would agree, hardly an entirely objective source in this instance, wrote of Northcliffe that he wielded power without official responsibility and disturbed the fortunes of national leaders without being willing to bear their burdens. While Northcliffe's newspapers did risk official censure, arguably contravened DORA and lost thousands of readers because of the Mail's campaign against Kitchener by reporting on what they described as the Shell Crisis in 1915 and blaming it on the Secretary of State for War, it would be a mistake to see this purely as proprietorial support for fearless investigative reporting. Northcliffe, as I said, had his own agenda. This involved support for Lloyd George, with whom he later fell out, and a desire to see Asquith out of power. However, the articles highlighting the Shell Crisis, which played into Lloyd George's hands, he became Minister for Munitions, as I'm sure you know, and later Prime Minister, did ensure that the man who wrote the story, originally Charles Revington, the Times correspondent, himself a former soldier, was banned from France for the better part of a year. However, my argument in the final analysis is not so much with the behaviour of proprietors, some of whom, as I've said, later became censors themselves, but with their employees at the front. The contention of Northcliffe and others, which smacks to me of special pleading, was that full disclosure of the course of the war, an end to misleading reports of unremitting and unlimited success, and an admission of failure and of significant reverses would galvanise the population and would aid recruitment, something not borne out by the end of voluntarism in late 1915 after the full scale of the Gallipoli disaster became apparent. One wonders whether the embedded correspondence, to use a latter-day phrase, would actually have taken full advantage of any relaxation of restrictions to report the unvarnished truth. So as I say, my argument is not really with the proprietors, it's with the journalists. There was a lot of adverse press coverage. There wasn't so much of the truth emanating from the Western Front, but the proprietors certainly and the editors were certainly aware of what was going on, as were the politicians, because they were being privately kept up to date. Now, of course, among the correspondents and journalists, I've already had a go at Gibbs. Gibbs was not unique in his self-censorship. He had it in common with his peers covering the Great War, and indeed with the great Fabian himself. While Bertrand Russell served time as a conscientious objector, George Bernard Shaw came to the front lines and had a look around. His reaction was unambiguous and untypical of a man who didn't like to be muzzled. While the war lasts, he wrote later, we must be our own censors. So essentially Shaw is taking the same line as Philip Gibbs. Self-censorship is, of course, hardly unique to the Great War and is not necessarily reprehensible. Journalists have often retained valuable information, the distribution of which they sincerely viewed as being contrary to the common good. In addition, any copy that sought to recount the unvarnished and ugly truth, the plain facts, and to be critical of the conduct of campaigns would never have got past the official censors anyway. But, as Gibbs noted in his memoir, the censors were hardly put to the pin of their collective colours, redlining acres of adverse copy. Ironically, where critical material, or even unvarnished but embarrassing facts, was censored, the deleted copy often found its way to the cabinet table, but not to the breakfast tables of ordinary readers. Lloyd George candidly admitted to C.P. Scott, the editor of The Guardian, and an opponent of the war in its early stages, that if people really knew the truth, the war would be stopped tomorrow. But of course they don't know and can't know. The conversation took place after Lloyd George had heard a personal account from Gibbs about the reality of the war on the Western Front. So Gibbs was reporting to politicians, but he wasn't reporting to his readers. It's kind of been, in modern day radio or television terms, it's like narrowcasting as opposed to broadcasting. Self-censorship, even in an extreme form, is understandable in the context of one's country facing a struggle for survival, as was clearly the case in World War I with Britain. One of the reasons, I think, for the more analytical and hostile coverage, and I think I'm being realistic here, of what I expect of or would expect of journalists, one of the reasons for the more analytical and hostile coverage of conflicts like the Crimean War in the 19th century or the Vietnam War in the 20th century was that Britain and the USA, in those instances, were clearly not involved in such a life or death struggle. There was an element of adventurism in both of those, and were accordingly not given a free pass by the likes of William Russell, Seymour Hersh, and David Halberstam. But, and here's, I think, my essential point, in addition to the passive act of self-censorship, outright misinformation was also purveyed by correspondence. There's no doubt that, knowingly or otherwise, British journalists were responsible for the dissemination of false information, and this was not designed to mislead the enemy. This was designed to mislead the general public. Did they do so culpably, or were they the dupes of clever propagandists in the military? Probably a bit of both. It's hard to credit that the correspondents actually believed a lot of the drivel that they wrote, based on information coming from Haig's staff about, for example, the first day of the Somme. The vantage point they were given to observe proceedings was not particularly advantageous, but they must surely have had some sense that the mission had been a total disaster, the single worst day in British military history. Gibbs was not the only correspondent who, by his own subsequent admission, falsified the record and offered woefully inaccurate and optimistic accounts of what was happening on the Western Front from 1916 to 1918. William Beach Thomas, seen here standing beside an unexploded shell. The shell is in the middle and he's on the right. responsible for one of the most egregiously ludicrous accounts of the Battle of the Somme, the lowlight of which read, "The very attitudes of the dead, fallen eagerly forward, have a look of expectant hope. You would say that they died with the light of victory in their eyes." I prefer to believe that they died with curses on their lips rather than the light of victory in their eyes. In 1925, Thomas wrote a memoir, a traveller in, they all wrote memoirs, a traveller in news, a memoir of his war experience in which he had the decency to express shame and revulsion, albeit belatedly, for his reporting of the war. "I was thoroughly and deeply ashamed," he wrote, "of what I had written, for the good reason that it was untrue. The vulgarity of enormous headlines and the enormity of one's own name did not lessen the shame. The problem was that you couldn't cover up indefinitely events that were being witnessed at close quarters by hundreds of thousands of troops. Hundreds of thousands of ordinary men were, for the first time, at the very centre of the major recurring daily news story. They were living the experiences the journalists were writing about and had first-hand knowledge of the accuracy and the veracity, or lack of both, of what was being written. They also had occasional access to the readership of the London newspapers when home on leave, and many of them were having newspapers sent to them, particularly officers. Officers were having newspapers sent to them on the front, and those newspapers would percolate down. The brutal reality of their lives was very much at odds with the often jaunty accounts of the correspondents, and this understandably infuriated and antagonised disillusioned soldiers. As Philip Knightley has put it, the ordinary soldier felt he had found the press out, and as a result he lost confidence in his newspapers, a confidence to this day that has never entirely recovered. The Siegfried Sassoon poem, Fight to the Finish, reflects this. It envisages soldiers turning on the crowd during a victory parade. It captures the soldiers' contempt for civilians but saves the worst revulsion for press and politicians. I heard the yellow pressmen grunt and squeal, and with my trusty bombers turned and went to clear those junkers out of Parliament. Even their ever-present censors didn't have much respect for the journalists. C.E. Montague noted in War Reportage a certain jauntiness of tone that roused the fighting troops to fury against the writers. Montague wrote of the average war correspondent in his war memoir, Disenchantment, in 1922, that through his dispatches there ran a brisk implication that the regimental officers and men enjoyed nothing better than going over the top, that their only fear was lest the war should end this side of the Rhine. This, the men reflected in helpless anger, was what people at home were offered as faithful accounts of what their friends in the field were thinking and suffering. This was not a phenomenon exclusive, this anger on the part of the troops was not a phenomenon exclusive to the British Army. The French troops, characterised in the French press as poilus, the hairy ones, French soldiers in the front line, unlike their British counterparts, were exempted from shaving, had a phrase. The French troops had a phrase that they used to describe accounts of the fighting in French newspapers. Bourrage de crâne, literally brain stuffing. And as with the British experience, there was more truth in a couple of pages of the Henri Barbusse novel Le Feu, translated as Under Fire, than in much of the French reportage of the war. Montague contrasted the treatment of the press in the early days of the war with the honours conferred on the small number of accredited correspondents in 1918. In the first months of the war, he said, our general staff treated British war correspondents as pariah dogs. They might escape arrest so long as they kept out of sight. That was about the sum of their privileges. And at the peace, all the regular pariah dogs were offered knighthoods. How did this sea change come about? Montague demonstrates that at some point, staff officers realised they had gone to the same schools as the erstwhile pariahs. Class solidarity clicked in. He goes on to say, when once known, the war correspondents were trusted and liked by the staff. There lay the trouble. They lived in the staff world, not in the combatant world. The staff was both their friend and their censor. How could they show it up when it failed? One of the first rules of field censorship was that from war correspondents, there must be no criticism of authority or command. How could they disobey that? They would visit the front now and then, as many staff officers did, but it could only be as afternoon callers from one of the many mansions of GHQ, that haven of security and comfort. The work of the war correspondents was satirised in the trench newspaper, the BEF Times, which started life as the Wipers Times, by what it's probably best known or better known. Between February 1916 and December 1918, Captain Fred Roberts and Lieutenant Jack Pearson used a printing press they had liberated. They took aim at GHQ, staff officers, the Germans, and the press. And they fastened on the output, in particular, of the Daily Mail correspondent I've already mentioned, William Thomas Beach, whose pretentious and portentous style, replete with egregious misinformation, was sent up in a number of bogus reports filed by the BEF Times special correspondent, Mr. Teach Bomas. It's a little bit undergraduate, I know, but there you go. Here's a flavour from the 1st of December 1916, where Bomas describes riding into battle on a tank. At last, we were fairly in amongst the Huns. They were round us and in millions they died. Every wag of our creature's tail threw a bomb with deadly precision, and the mad, muddled murderers melted. How to describe the joy with which our men joined the procession until at last we had a train 10 miles long. Now, I would contend that if you were to put that piece of satire beside one of Thomas's own reports, it might be difficult to distinguish between the two. The mock dispatch obviously satirises his lofty style, his penchant for exaggeration. And earlier that year, Roberts and Pearson had taken a swipe at Northcliffe himself in a poem entitled Wales to the Mail, which included a reference to his power and influence as leading proprietor of what they call the Hide the Truth Press. Northcliffe, my Northcliffe, greater than Mars, or double-faced Janus, whose portal unbars the flood tide of battle, the Polian of Pars, as in paragraphs, whose words are uncensored, whose leader compels Greys, Asquiths, McKennas, and Eek, double L's, whatever that is, with contraband cotton and scandal of shells. Now, here's where I finally come to grips with Gallipoli. My apologies for taking so long to get to it. But the single most successful effort to publish the truth about a failed military campaign in World War I probably occurred in relation to Gallipoli. The Mediterranean Force commander, the 62-year-old General Sir Ian Hamilton, a likeable, personally courageous, but unfortunately rather hapless general, unlike Hitchin or Craig, had no particular loathing for journalists, and he agreed to take on a small number of correspondents when the Mediterranean expedition began, something he was to later regret. These included Ellis Ashmead Bartlett of the Daily Telegraph and Henry Nevinson of the Guardian. Nevinson came a little bit later. They were taken along with the Mediterranean force to cover the campaign. Now, Ashmead Bartlett had originally been assigned to the Navy with the approval of Churchill to cover the maritime operation in March of 1915, a month before the land invasion. So he may not have felt that he owed any particular loyalty to Hamilton. Ashmead Bartlett quickly became disillusioned with the conduct of the campaign. And when a young Australian reporter, Keith Murdoch, who's the father of Rupert Murdoch, arrived in Gallipoli in September 1915 to officially, at least, report on the alleged mismanagement of the Australian mail service at Anzac Cove, Ashmead Bartlett confined his misgivings about the conduct of the campaign to Murdoch. A little bit about Ashmead Bartlett himself. He was a curmudgeonly former Tory parliamentary candidate who, it has to be said, had made up his mind about the Gallipoli campaign probably before it began. Also, as a Conservative and as a correspondent for the Daily Telegraph, he wouldn't have had any great love of the Liberal government. Employed by the Telegraph, his dispatches were highly coloured, often exaggerated, and often inaccurate, but very, very readable. He quickly became almost obsessed with the Anzac forces. It's almost a homoerotic obsession, it has to be said. And much of his coverage of their activities was actually favoured by Australian newspapers over the reports of the official Australian war correspondent, Charles E.W. Bean, who had beaten out Murdoch in a ballot for the position. Bean later, of course, later an eminent historian, but whose journalism was a good deal more workmanlike than that of Ashmead Bartlett. Now, Bartlett was unpopular with his fellow correspondents. He was actually unpopular with pretty much everybody in Gallipoli, and particularly with many of the officers that he came in contact with. Part of the reason for that was that he managed to maintain a relatively sumptuous lifestyle in the semi-desert that was Gallipoli. He erected an elaborate tent for himself. He would drink copious amounts of champagne. I have no idea where he got it from, so please don't ask me. He would dress in a silk robe in the evenings, and he actually imported a French chef to cook for him. Now, contrast that with what I think John and Keith are going to tell you about what was the reality of Gallipoli. The story is told, for example, by Compton Mackenzie. When he went to Gallipoli at the behest of Hamilton, was already a very successful novel. The Sinister Street had come out at that stage, and Mackenzie actually briefly ended up replacing Bartlett as the official correspondent of the Western Front, even though he was actually a military officer. And Mackenzie, the story Mackenzie tells in his own memoir of Gallipoli, is setting out with Bartlett at Bartlett's request to visit a British position, hoping to talk to some of the British officers. Now, Bartlett had initiated the journey, but he soon abandoned it because of his dislike of walking anywhere. When he arrived, Mackenzie continued the journey. When he arrived, Mackenzie found the encampment completely deserted, and he was very suspicious and he was worried about this. And when it became apparent, though, who the visitor was, that it was just Mackenzie, the officers emerged all from all over the place from concealment and apologised to Compton Mackenzie, explaining that they had absconded because they had feared that they might Ashmead Bartlett might be on the way, and they did not wish to offer him lunch. Anyway, the Daily Telegraph correspondent offered Murdoch, Keith Murdoch, the young Australian journalist, chapter and verse in justification of his tirade against Hamilton, and he also complained about the censorship of dispatches from the Dardanelles. This at a time when information from the Western Front was still being doled out to the newspapers by eyewitness. Eyewitness was Colonel Ernest Swinton, a GHQ staff officer whose job it was to disseminate news of which Kitchener approved, I hasten to add. So devoid were his reports of any discernible news value that he soon came to be dubbed eyewash. So even censored journalistic copy coming from Gallipoli was an improvement on what Eyewitness or Eyewash was coming up with, but that still wasn't good enough for Ashmead Bartlett. Fair enough. I mean, that is the job of a journalist to hit out against any kind of censorship and to rail against censorship. So what happened was that Ashmead Bartlett got Murdoch, who was only there temporarily, to agree to carry a letter from him directly to the Prime Minister Asquith, apprising Asquith of the realities of Gallipoli and, as he saw it, the incompetence of General Sir Ian Hamilton. The other British correspondent, Henry Nevinson, who was father of the famous World War I artist C.R.W., Nevinson, who painted the wonderful Paths to Glory in 1917, got wind of what Ashmead Bartlett and Murdoch were cooking up. And he saw this as a betrayal of Hamilton's trust, which is an interesting point of view for a journalist, I would have thought. And in this, Hamilton, as far as Nevinson was concerned, had allowed Ashmead Bartlett access in a way that was denied on the Western Front. That much was true, but it's still the job of a journalist to do their job. And what Nevinson did was that he arranged for Keith Murdoch to be arrested in Marseille by military police, and for the letter that had been entrusted to him by Ashmead Bartlett to be confiscated. This is honour among thieves, amongst journalists. In response, what happened was that Murdoch simply wrote an even more bitter diatribe using what Ashmead Bartlett had written to Asquith, and he sent that to his own Prime Minister, who in turn, of course, sent it to Asquith. So Nevinson's ruse did not work. On hearing of Murdoch's letter and becoming aware of Ashmead Bartlett's attitude and prior correspondence, the Northcliffe Press, not Ashmead Bartlett's own newspaper, The Telegraph, but Northcliffe's Press, swung into action. And the coverage of the controversy was ramped up by one of Northcliffe's own newspapers, The Sunday Times, which actually bypassed the censorship laws to some extent by interviewing Murdoch rather than publishing Bartlett's uncensored dispatch. Now, they were still obviously subject to the Defence of the Realm Act, but they were not subject to censorship from Gallipoli. And the reportage of this hastened the dismissal of Hamilton, which took place in October 1915. Now again, however, it must be emphasised that the Gallipoli affair played into Northcliffe's campaign to have Kitchener stripped of some of his powers. Ashmead Bartlett was subsequently blackballed by the army and was not allowed to return to the field as a reporter. He was one of the few, interestingly, the few accredited war correspondents who was not knighted after the war. Now, aside altogether from the obvious role of the censor in the Gallipoli campaign before Ashmead Bartlett blew the whistle, there's some evidence of parallel statistical manipulation of casualty figures in the Gallipoli campaign by the War Office. In my own research among the papers of World War I veterans in the Imperial War Museum, there's, for example, a reference in one of the letters home from Gallipoli of Lieutenant Guy Nightingale, one of the most interesting of the soldiers who arrived on V Beach on the 25th of April 1915 of the 1st Battalion of the Royal Munster Fusiliers. And Nightingale wrote of that day to his mother, "I see they are breaking the casualties gently to you at home. Out of the 14 officers of ours hit on Sunday the 25th of April, the Times of the 2nd of May only gives one killed and five wounded. I suppose they'll try to make out it's been nothing at all out here, just a scrap with the Turks, whereas it's been hell and frightfully mismanaged." So, you know, and in fairness, it wasn't just the journalists who were purveying misinformation, it was the military itself who were attempting to manipulate and purvey misinformation, which I'm sure comes as absolutely no surprise to you. Nightingale was essentially alleging that the figures were being managed, they were being parcelled out to distract from the enormity of the casualties on the first day of the Gallipoli campaign and to suppress any interrogation of the efficacy of the plan for the Helles landings, which were particularly bloody when it came to V Beach and next door on W Beach. Of course, therein lay the Achilles heel of rigorous censorship. While the War Office might censor journalistic dispatches, and they did, or while they might release casualty information to suit their own purposes, which they certainly did in the case of the 25th of April 1915, that information eventually had to be released at some point, and it didn't take an overly avid newspaper reader to realise that casualties, and in particular fatalities, had no precedent in any other conflict involving the British armed forces. And this is one of the things that led, of course, to the end of voluntarism and to the introduction of conscription in 1916. But the time of the Somme, the High Command and the British government were in the same boat. They were in blood stepped in so far to return were as tedious as to go war, as a certain Scottish military and political leader might have put it. I'm not going to mention his name because there could be actors present. Archibald Bartlett's reports had provided a convenient scapegoat for the Gallipoli disaster in Sir General Sir Ian Hamilton, disposed of Churchill to the delight of his political enemies and allowed for a withdrawal from Turkey. At that point in the war, such reverses were tolerable. Even earlier than that, the official censor himself, the MP F.E. Smith, who later became Lord Birkenhead, placed in charge of the press bureau by Kitchener and actually tweaked the outrage in a newspaper dispatch from the Irish journalist Arthur Moore of the time. So you have this interesting conflict, and it's not a simple conflict. We don't want the information to get out. Oh, that's the government. We do want the information to get out. That's the newspapers. It wasn't as simple as that. It's much more complex. And if you look at this particular instance, I think it's very revealing, because Smith actually tweaked the dispatch of the so-called Amiens or Amiens dispatch, which was about the British retreat from Mons in 1914. Smith, who was aware of the debacle that was taking place and conscious that for political and military reasons the British population needed to hear the unvarnished truth, added a paragraph of his own to Moore's already alarming report, highlighting the fact that, in his own words, the BEF has suffered terrible losses and requires immediate reinforcement. It needs men, 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 and yet more men. We want reinforcements and we want them now. So that, in fact, is essentially agreeing with the contention of the newspaper proprietors that the unvarnished truth should get out, and that will lead to more volunteers. I don't think it would have worked out that way, but in some instances their interests were coterminous, in some instances their interests were antagonistic. I'm going to wrap up fairly quickly and pose the question: did or does any of this really matter? Well, it certainly did in World War II. So cynical were people about newspaper coverage in wartime that Holocaust denial during the war itself, the Second World War, became almost a reflex action. And this was one of the legacies of propaganda masquerading as truth and misinformation coming directly from newspaper correspondents themselves. It took the likes of the Second World War of Edward R. Murrow and Richard Dimbleby, employing the relatively new medium of radio, to disabuse people of their complacency when it came to the genocide of European Jews. Now, I'm not blaming that genocide on Gibbs and Beach Thomas, but they contributed to the ability of people to disassociate themselves from it, to disbelieve. Gibbs, Beach Thomas, and other World War I correspondents made it easier to dismiss reports that you didn't want to hear or believe. The failure of journalistic nerve in the Great War led in some small way to the even greater war that followed a generation later. Bear in mind the millions of British survivors of this ugly, evil conflict, whose cynicism about journalistic coverage of their war is enhanced by the self-serving post-war memoirs of generals extolling their own virtues, and of journalists admitting that they were, at the very least, shamelessly manipulated and shamefully manipulated. And then disillusionment sets in. Knightley's dissonance between reader and newspaper prevails to an even greater extent, with the absolute confirmation by the former correspondents themselves that what passed for journalism in World War I was actually propaganda. This in turn leads inexorably to significant British dissatisfaction with the treatment meted out to Germany at Versailles, which leads to appeasement, the results of which we know only too well. Maybe I'm overstretching a little bit, but I do think it had an impact. The better known poets of the war, those who expressed their disgust with the conduct of the conflict, were as embedded as the journalists, far more so in fact. Perhaps they had the benefit, if it can be described as such, of a more realistic first-hand acquaintance with the true horrors of the conflict. And it was that direct and intense experience that informed their poetry. Perhaps in that experiential sense at least, they were at an advantage over the scribes of the Fourth Estate, because the likes of Siegfried Sassoon and Wilfred Owen were the Robert Fiskes of the Great War. Their writing was a more honest response to what they saw around them. They did not and could not willfully blind themselves to what was happening. Their work, stripped of special pleading, chauvinism and self-delusion, spoke truth to power, and was in this instance, not journalism, poetry, the first draft of history. Thank you very much.
Speaker, Professor Keith Jeffery needs no introduction and sit down at that point, but that really won't do. Keith is well known to many of us, has taught a number of us in this room at either the University of Ulster or Queen's University of Belfast. He's been at Queen's now for about 10 years, I think. Published a wide range of books on military history, which again are familiar to many of us, with most relevance to what he's talking about today. His book Ireland and the Great War remains the best single volume history of the conflict and Ireland, and is still available from all good bookshops. It's been recently republished in paperback. And the big work that he's been working on recently is on 1916, so it's a global history of the First World War in that year. I'm told that that will be published on October 15, so available in time for Christmas. That will resolve many Christmas gifts. I'm particularly looking forward to his coverage of the Mexican Revolution and the campaigns in Southwest Africa, which I'm sure will be covered in enormous detail, amongst Jutland, the Somme, Easter Rising, and all the more obvious ones. So that will be something well worth looking out for in a year when I think we're going to be swamped with military history books. This will be a very special one that I think will repay close reading. So Keith's now going to talk to us about Ireland and Gallipoli, so very much looking forward to what you have to say.
Well, thank you, Tim. You say all the right things. And I can assure you that the Mexican Revolution and the campaigns in Africa will be covered, or are covered, the book in sufficient detail. Now, what I'm going to do is just, it's really a whistle-stop tour around the various aspects of Ireland engagement with the Irish troops and Irish peoples and the Irish memory of Gallipoli, which is, for so long, and particularly in this part of the world, the Somme has dominated our perception of the First World War, and indeed the Western Front is the default. It's quite interesting, when I was recently having a discussion about the cover for the book, one of my points about the 1916 book is that the war happens elsewhere, the perception of the war is quite literally, I say in the introduction, got stuck in the mud of the Western Front. And the first picture they produced for the cover was, of course, a man up to his excursion in mud on the Western Front. And I said, no. That's part of the story, but it's not all the story. Now, I've just come back from Australia, and the Australians, of course, for them, the Western Front hardly exists. It's all Gallipoli. And I think if the happenstance of deployment in the First World War had sent the 36th Ulster Division to Gallipoli, we would now be in the same position as the Australians, the kind of contribution to the creation story of the state, the sense that the Anzacs became representative of a new kind of nationality and nationhood and identity. We might have the same position as well, but it wasn't, of course, to be. Now, direct Irish military involvement with Gallipoli falls into two distinct parts. First, that of regular British Army units on the first landings in April 1915, and the second concerning Irishmen who joined up in the Kitchener's new armies from the autumn of 1914 onwards. And among the regular units serving with the British 29th Division, which was sent to here, I'll just whistle through. Tim Bowman's going to talk about the strategy of this, so you don't really need to know where Gallipoli is, but there it is. as you can test it on later. But here's the peninsula as it is today. And the first landings occur down here at the point of the peninsula, and also up here at Anzac Cove. I'll come back to this Turkish defences in a minute. So among the regular units serving with the 29th Division, who land down here around Cape Hillis, are two the 1st Royal Dublin Fusiliers and the 1st Royal Munster Fusiliers. And they land here at V Beach. I have a word to say at V Beach, Sid El Bar, we've heard about Sid El Bar almost already. And then the Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers land at X Beach, which is just around the corner up here.
So the notion was to capture the peninsula in order to neutralise the and move up to neutralise the naval guns, which had prevented the navy, as we'll hear later. Tom Thorpe, I think, is going to talk about the naval attack which preceded these amphibious landings here. Now, the mixed experiences of these units, the Dublins, the Munsters and the Inniskillings, matched that of the British and, of course, the British Imperial invasion forces as a whole. The Inniskillings, in fact, up here, landed without a casualty, as their regimental history records. Their Southern Irish colleagues suffered devastating losses. And down here, now, the Turks, you can see the, it's comparatively lightly defended here. X Beach, 12 men, you see, if you look at close at this. Now, right at the head of the peninsula, this was the strong point. There's a castle here at Zed El Bar. It's well entrenched and guarded, and there are machine guns and there are artillery here overlooking D Beach. Here again, you can see it, and we don't need to worry about that. Turkish defences, quite significant here above V Beach, much lighter round the corner here. Here we are. This is a very famous picture, a photograph taken, I think, on the first day of the landing, the 25th, and this is from the River Clyde. The idea was, this is an ex-collier, a kind of Trojan horse. They were full of classical allusions. Now you can, I mean, Troy is just across the Dardanelles from here, and all those officers and writers who brought up with good classical educations were mesmerised by the wine dark sea, you know, around Gallipoli, and the kind of romance of the whole thing up here. But it was really quite a good idea. You had an armoured or a collier which had been reinforced a bit, and it was going to run itself aground, and the Munsters. And some company of the Hampshires were going to jump out of this and a sort of bridge would be built to the coast, and they would reach. Now, a couple of things happened to this. Firstly, it didn't hit the shore quickly enough, so it didn't get close enough. So there's this fatal sort of gap between here and the shore. And secondly, of course, this well-defended, obviously you can see this the castle here and the defences. About four companies of the Munsters and one of the Dublins, along with two companies of the Hampshire Regiment, were positioned in the ex-Collier River Clyde. And it's run onto the beach. And the remaining companies of the Dublins landed directly onto the shore from open boats over here to the left. So. Now, it was always going to be a hazardous operation. No one expected this to be done without casualties. In fact, the surprise was that other parts of the other landings, other beaches, were relatively unscathed. But it was a nightmare. And we have eyewitness accounts of this. Myles Dungan has already talked about Guy Nightingale and his astonishing correspondence, which reminds us, and I think Myles valuably reminds us, of the numerous kinds of sources of information coming back home about what happens in the war. You get the official reports, which kind of sanitize it. You get the journalist reports, which romanticize it. You get soldiers' reports, many of which self-censor. We're having a great time, you know, a bit sticky, but not too bad, sort of whistling to keep up. But you also get, cutting through these, and it is astonishing when you stumble upon these things, absolutely uncensored and unvarnished views of this at the same time. And Nightingale is one of the sources of this, and a fellow Munster Fusiliers company commander, G.W. Geddes, who also has an eyewitness account at the time. Geddes reflect on the comparison between Gallipoli and the Western Front. Men who were at Mons and La Basse, he said, say it was sheer child's play to what we've gone through here. His account described the difficulties the Munsters had getting ashore from the River Clyde, which was not close enough, as you can see, for the men to wade in. We were shot down like flies, and as it then meant swimming ashore, many of my men were drowned, as the weight of the packs we had to carry was staggering. They had carry 3 days' rations, 200 rounds of ammunition, overcoats, Macintosh sheets. It was the most ghastly hell you can imagine, and you might just as well have walked the plank. you can form no idea of the horror of the undertaking. Two splendid regiments practically wiped out. And this was Geddes, who was on the River Clyde, writing about this. Now, this interesting picture, you can just about make out the survivors who got to the shore and are sheltering here under a bluff from the Turkish guns. Now, they landed about 6:30, the landing started about 6:30. They stopped the landings at 9 o'clock, in fact, when there's still 1,000 men on the Clyde, and resume it at night when many of them landed without casualties. So, again, it's not absolutely just sending men straight to their death. It's a contentious term in terms of Western Front, a kind of learning curve operating at the instant of this. But anyway, so great were the losses of the Munsters and the Dublins in that early first morning. We both left England 1,000 strong, and together we were 8 officers and 770 men, so about 50%, more than 50% casualties, that the two units were temporarily combined into a composite battalion called Dubsters. Now, Nightingale's letters to his sister mostly reflect a very common ostentatious devil-may-care attitude cultivated by many junior officers. But as I say, they are extraordinarily vivid, and he was a very troubled man, in fact, and didn't have a happy experience after the war. The impact that these soldiers, or the impact that it had in Ireland, was quite significant. Again, and it reminds us that it's not just the men who joined up at the beginning of the First World War, but the pre-war professionals. These Dubliners are, you know, men from the Dublin inner city. The Munsters, these are traditional army families who've joined up, the Inniskillings as well. So you get a concentration of response from their constituencies back home. And that's one response that happens. Now, the second engagement, direct military engagement with the Irish, comes a few months later in August 1915, when they're trying to, what has happened at Gallipoli, of course, is that it sort of settles down to kind of war of attrition, a bit like the Western Front. And like Gallipoli, it's supposed to be a solution sort of round the side from the Western Front. So even at Gallipoli, they try to have this this is it today, and the location of the River Clyde. And again, you can see there are Turkish forces up here, and of course these extraordinary Commonwealth War Grave cemeteries by the sort of Mediterranean Sea. That's as far as they got. Really, this is by May. You see just over a mile in, and it settles down to this kind of war of attrition. So they decide to try and let's go back here, back up top to have another landing up here to try and turn the flank of the Turks. These are the other Irishmen who are involved here. These are the Irishmen who join up in responding to the "Your country needs you" Kitchener's call, the so-called war enthusiasm of the autumn of 1914. Now, a lot of work has been done on this, and the war enthusiasm is not as enthusiastic as you might think, and indeed not all Irishmen join up in the first sort of 20 minutes of the war, as the kind of casual received wisdom has of it. There is no program almost about the First World War that doesn't have pictures of that great Kitchener poster and the crowds of people turning up at the recruiting stations and all the rest of it. No, it's not as straightforward as that. 50% of the Irishmen who volunteer in the only 50% of the Irishmen who volunteer in the First World War join up in the first 6 months. So 50% of them join up after the first 6 months. And one of the things I'm quite interested in when you're looking at narratives of recruitment and rationale for recruitment are not the people who join up in those that first flush of enthusiasm, but the people who join up afterwards. Because they, you know, their story is just as important as the other. And in fact, there are 10,000 Irishmen who join up in the last 3.5 months of the war. 10,000. By which stage, no matter what, Eyewitness or Eyewash or, you know, Philip Gibbs or all that kind of a story you've got, the casualty lists will have told their own story by then, and no one's going to be disabused in the spring of 1918 that they're getting into some kind of bun fight that's going to be over by Christmas and going to be a lot of fun. So any explanation you have to find for why people join up, and it's not so strange, maybe, we could discuss it later, but any explanation as to why people join up not only has to tell us about the enthusiasm of these men in September 1914 in the Aviva Stadium. It's been improved since, I gather, on Lansdowne Road. But it also has to take account of those 10,000 young men in the last 3.5 months of the war. So I offer that as a wee cautionary tale. But this is the 10th Irish Division. This is the most famous, best recorded formation of the 10th Irish Division. They became part of D Company, the 7th Royal Dublin Fusiliers. And the 10th Irish Division was one of the three new army divisions raised from the beginning of the war, the other two being the 16th Irish Division, which is by and large the most nationalist of them, John Redmond's pets, and of course the 36th Ulster Division, which represents a different Irish political disposition, let's say, for this. But the 10th Irish Division is in some way the purest, if you like. It's the least political, it's the soonest raised, and it's the soonest deployed. By 1915, these guys, here they are, marching off to the Curragh going down past. This is the old Kildare Street Club, the Alliance Française. In both cases, they would have been looking out and cheering on these guys going to, they certainly thought they were going to France. Oops, sorry. I assume they're coming from Lansdowne Road, along the way to the barracks, somewhere. But you can see that these are sort of middle class, these are young men, these are solicitors, these are shop assistants, these are awkwardly mobile, aspirational, bourgeois. These aren't the desperate, working class looking for a job, who by some accounts might have populated the pre-war professional army. This is the new army, and it's of course very characteristic of these PALS battalions in Britain as well as Ireland, is that they represent networks of people in a way that hadn't happened before. David Fitzpatrick, historian at Trinity College Dublin, has spoken about the logic of collective sacrifice, and he says that these networks are fantastically important in sort of multiplying the numbers joining up. And you get people who've already been in the Ulster Volunteer Force, or the Irish Volunteers, or who work together, or who play together, all joining up together. And of course, in many cases, they die together as well. The second landings are up at Suvla in the north. As I say, they've established this kind of static trench system here, and this static system around Anzac Cove, and the idea was to have a renewed offensive in August, in which there would be an offensive here, there would be an offensive here, and there would be a bit of an offensive here, a sort of coordinated thing. Didn't of course quite work out like this. And they landed on the 6th of August, three battalions from the 10th Irish Division. Two of them land here, and one of them lands a bit further south, and in fact is deployed with the Anzacs. We'll come to them in a minute. And they're very well recorded, because these are the sorts of people who write their own history. And that's one of the problems we have, is that we know much more about the 7th Dublin Fusiliers because there's a sort of loving history of them themselves. There is a general history by Brian Cooper, a former MP and later a TD from Sligo, of the 10th Irish Division as well, generally, and I'll quote him in a minute. But the 31st Brigade, which is one of the brigades of the 10th Irish Division, was under the command of a man called Hill, and his orders were to take Chocolate Hill, which is just inland here, from Suvla Bay, a mile or so inland. And eventually they take the hill on the early evening of 6th or 7th of August, in 1915. And Hill recalls this, and they're not very well trained. This is neither the landings at the beginning of the campaign, nor these landings at Suvla. This is not D-Day, this is not Overlord. These are guys who are very, very untrained. They're unprepared for amphibious landings against defended posts. As you've seen, even the comparatively careful and not stupid preparations made for V Beach go badly wrong, of course. But anyway, Hill was unstinting in his praise for the raw 10th Division troops. Landed straight into action and under fire for the first time in an unknown country to them, in the hottest season of the year, and after but a rapid and elementary training of under a year. Heavily loaded and short of water, officers and men behaved throughout the day magnificently. At one point, the footballers, this is the 7th Dublins, had dashed forward, he said, for all the world, like a wild forward rush at Lansdowne Road. There's that kind of romantic, you know, devil-may-care stuff, isn't it? But the Dublin pals also lost 22 men in these early engagements, including Lieutenant Ernest L. Julian, Reed Professor of Law at Trinity College Dublin. Now, there are not many professors of anything in the British Army these days, but there were, and again, it shows the extraordinary reach of that moment of recruitment, that network, which seemed to work in the autumn of 1914. And they move on to fight. Here's Civil Bay, there's Chocolate Hill, okay? It turned into an exercise to try and again turn the Turks' flanks. And the main deployment of the 10th Irish Division was up this ridge, Kirich Tepe Seert, which they, within a fortnight later, or a week later, they move up Kirich Tepe Seert Ridge. And that was a desperate fight in this distant place, fighting uphill against entrenched Turks, who obviously had the advantage of the land here. The pals suffer very heavy casualties up here. In a bayonet charge against Turkish bombers, who of course are rolling these bombs down the hill, almost everyone in the charge was killed or wounded. At roll call on the 16th of August, only one officer, another Trinity College Dublin man, from D Company was present, and he was wounded in the foot. Reflecting on these losses, within a year of the evacuation of Gallipoli, Brian Cooper, who wrote an account of this and served in the peninsula with the Connaught Rangers, observed that the 10th Division had been shattered. The work of a year had been destroyed in a week, and nothing material had been gained, yet all was not in vain. It is, he continued in an understandably gloomy tone, no new thing for the sons of Ireland to perish in a forlorn hope and a fruitless struggle. They go forth to battle only to fall, yet there springs from their graves a glorious memory for the example of future generations. Now that's a very, very interesting statement. I mean, it's involved, there's a romantic idea of war, but do you see the resonance of the sorts of things Patrick Pearse is saying at home? At exactly the same time, dead generations feeding into a tradition. So there's a very interesting parallel, a kind of mobilisation and engagement with war as an attractive or necessary or feasible option. And that's very important for us when we try and get back to understanding what the First World War is all about and what motivates these men at the time. The battle at Kirich Tepe Seert, wrote Cooper, was a little known fight in an unlucky campaign. But if the young soldiers of the 10th Division who died there added a single leaf to Ireland's crown of cypress and laurel, their death was not in vain. So not about beating the Turks, not about winning the war, but about simply adding a single leaf to Ireland's crown of cypress and laurel, which maybe it did for Cooper, but it might not do for us today. The two of the brigades, as I mentioned, of the 10th Irish Division are fighting up here. A third brigade from the division are deployed with the Anzacs down here, the 29th Brigade. This is the one that Cooper himself's in. Leinster Regiment, or Royal Irish Rifles, and Connaught Rangers, and a unit of the Hampshires, who were added to make up numbers. And they're reserves troops for the 1st Australian Brigade. And there's a wonderful quote here from Cooper, some of you will have heard this already, but it bears re-quoting. It's sheltering in Shrapnel Gully under Turkish shellfire. Shrapnel Gully's in here, right under the heights where the Turks and Mustafa Kemal are entrenched. But sheltering in Shrapnel Gully, Brian Cooper in the 5th Connaughts records that they saw their first Australians. Some were stripped to the waist, and a few wore more clothing than boots, a slouch hat, a sleeveless shirt open at the breast, and a pair of the shortest shorts that ever occurred to the imagination of a tailor. As a result of this primitive costume, they were burnt to a rich brown by the Gallipoli sun. They were splendid men, but quite different in physique from the European. They were, for their sloping shoulders, loose-knit limbs, and long, thin legs suggested an apparent reversion to the kangaroo type as the result of climatic conditions. Above all, they seemed absolutely devoid of nerves. Clearly, they were good men to fight side by side with. Now, this is complete nonsense. What we do know from quite a lot of the work being done in the Australian Imperial Force is that most of them were city dwellers and they weren't from the bush at all. Very few of them seemed to revert to the kangaroo type. Most of them had been in Australia for about, a fortnight before they join up to come out again, kind of thing. And many of them themselves are Irish, as wonderful work of Jeff Kilday has done in his Australian-Irish, Australian Imperial Force project, tracing the Irish in Irish Anzacs of one sort or another. But it's this wonderful perception of these raw, kind of pasty-faced Irishmen landing and being faced by these veterans. Now, they're veterans of. Those Australians have been there only since April, so it was scarcely 6 months, if that. And you do get report about these extraordinary people who have adapted to the terrible circumstances of the war, absolutely devoid of nerves. They've got a coping mechanism, they've worked out a kind of survival mechanism as best they can, and it's, you know, it certainly impresses these raw and untried troops at this time. Now, the 10th Division don't stay very long. By early October they're evacuated and they go on to Salonika. There's another desperate kind of forgotten campaign. And from Salonika they go on to Palestine. So from one contested territory to another, how suitable for an Irish unit to be sent to these. Now, despite Brian Cooper's belief that Ireland will not easily forget the deeds of the 10th Division, it seems Ireland did precisely that. There is a whole sort of literature about so-called national amnesia that occurs certainly in nationalist Ireland about Ireland's engagement with the war, which of course has changed over recent years, as we'll see. And the Irish experience with Gallipoli is the diametric opposite of the Australian and New Zealand one, in that sense. And there are five ways in which the Irish at Gallipoli are marginalised, are multiply marginalised and neglected. Firstly, the obvious one in independent Ireland, or Ireland becoming independent, as Irish soldiers fighting in British uniforms in the First World War, they get neglected. I don't think they get completely neglected in the interwar years. There was a kind of debate about this, because there are a very substantial, large-scale Armistice Day processions and celebrate or commemorations of one sort or another happened between the wars. The Irish National War Memorial is built at Isle Bridge. War Memorial has been put up in all sorts of places in the south, Longford, Cork, Kerr, Killarney, and so on. Not Killarney, Nina, and so on. But by and large, there was a suppression of any public engagement with the rituals of First World War commemoration, particularly in the 1940s and 50s and 60s. Second reason the Irish are marginalised who fought at Gallipoli is that they're at Gallipoli and not at the Western Front, and our perceptions are much more of the Western Front. That's where the real action is, that's where it matters. The Somme is the big grown-up battle of all, and that's the one. And it's at the Somme where both the Ulster Division on the 1st of July, absolutely unforgettably, and the 16th Irish Division in September are first seriously blooded, and very seriously it was too. So in that sense, the Gallipoli becomes marginalised in our perceptions of the war. A third reason is the Irish is that they are a minority in a predominantly British and indeed French theatre. There are more French people at Gallipoli, we haven't talked about them at all, than there are Australians or New Zealanders, but they're largely forgotten as well. Many of them are colonial French troops, that's one of the reasons for this. You might have seen Peter Weir's famous 1982 movie Gallipoli, which, you know, expresses an understanding that there are Australians at Gallipoli for no Australian reason. These are men who have no part of a war being thrown into a battle for some British imperial reasons which has nothing to do with themselves. And they display valour and courage and high achievement, as it were, for this, high commitment for this, but it's not really an Australian business. And at the denouement of the movie, when the Australians are going to their death, the neck over the top, the light horse, someone looks down the beach, they're up here, and a guy looks down and on Suvla Bay and says, what are the British doing, the English doing in Suvla Bay? They're sitting drinking cups of tea while the Australians are dying at the top. And in that metaphor is the whole rationale of the movie, or part of the rationale of the movie. No, it didn't suit Peter Weir's political view. In fact, it's the Irish sitting on, if they're drinking cups of tea, presumably Irish tea, Jana, it's Irish sitting there. It didn't suit his political political view. But the Irish don't appear, and the Irish have only reappeared in Gallipoli as a result of independent Ireland. It reflects contemporary political perceptions about the distinctiveness of the, as it were, British or British Isles component of the campaign. And as Scotland becomes more independent, we'll have people finding the Scottish regiments at Gallipoli separately, and then there'll be Welsh regiments, and then there'll be everything, there'll be Yorkshire regiments, you know, Hampshire nationalists will look for that, and so on, kind of go on like this forever. The fourth way they're marginalised, the Irish Gallipoli, is of course the regulars, because we do neglect it. I mean, a lot of the attention in our recovery and these celebrations or commemorations and revisiting of the war look at the volunteers, the nation in arms, those people, as it were, like us, who, if we're not military types, who are, you know, civilians, who are swept up into this extraordinary, catastrophic experience. And sometimes we forget those who are actually joined up to be soldiers, professional soldiers, in one way or another. And the Pyrenean Skillings are even more marginalised for landing without any loss. I mean, what were they doing? You know? And you get this sort of odd sense, occasional odd sense, of disappointment when the casualties are low. It's an odd thing. I teach a course on Ireland in the First World War, and I always get the students to look up the Commonwealth War Graves Register to find someone with their family name or, you know, relative. And they always will. You know, variants of spellings, but everyone's fine. I say, great, that's a result. And then you have to pause and you think, you found someone dead. It's not actually a great result for the person you found at all. And you forget that of the all the people mobilised in the armed services in the First World War, 90% survive, 10% over, you know, only die in that sense. And there's a huge focus on the dead, rightly so, I have to say, but sometimes neglecting the living and the survivors of the time as well. So there is a sort of marginalisation there, particularly for regulars and not the others. And then the fifth marginalised part of the Irish Gallipoli are the Pearl 29th Brigade. Cooper's lot, who fight with the Anzacs and get lost somehow in the narrative a bit, get lost in the commemoration. Now, some indeed in Ireland thought there was almost nothing to celebrate at all about any campaign in the First World War, any part in it. Dora Sigerson Shorter, the passionate Irish Republican, slips a reference to Gallipoli into a poem, Loud Shout the Flaming Tongues of War, which she wrote during the war, in which she celebrates the Irish dead of the East 1916 Rising, and excoriates those who'd fallen under the spell of the Lion, England, and misguidedly gone to fight in the Great War. In the poem, the martyrs of 1916 are mourned by Gráinne Mhaoil. This is Grace O'Malley, the legendary late 16th century pirate captain and prototype Irish feminist and patriot. But that's another lecture for another day. But anyway, here's Sigerson Shorter's or stanza from it. Ah, Gráinne Mhaoil, thy stricken head is bowed in sorrow o'er thy dead who died for love of thee, not for some foreign liberty. Shall we betray, when hope is near, our motherland whom we hold dear, to go to fight on foreign strand, for foreign rights and foreign land? So, Suvla Bay is dismissed as no more than a foreign strand, while the rights of small nations and gallant little Belgium and so on are merely foreign rights and foreign land. and the notion of the First World War being simply a futile and costly imperial conflict in which Irish lives, among others, Australians too, are needlessly wasted is one which remains fresh, not just in Irish Republican circles. And here the Gallipoli campaign sometimes receives a mention. One of the most popular and enduring Irish rebel songs of modern times is The Foggy Dew, written by a parish priest from Newcastle, County Down, Father later Canon Charles O'Neill, sometime shortly after he witnessed the first meeting of the Irish Republican Parliament, the Doyle, in Dublin in 1919. The song reflects on the contrast between those Irish who fought with the rebels in 1916 and those who served with the British Army in the Great War. Right proudly high over Dublin town, they hung out the flag of war. 'Twas better to die 'neath an Irish sky than at Suvla or Sedd el Bahr. 'Twas England, Bage, or Wild Geese go that small nations might be free, but their lonely graves are by Suvla's waves and the fringe of the grey North Sea. Now, well, some pictures I haven't shown you, but there you are. These are Suvla Bay, but we move rapidly on. There's Tirish Kevi Seart. Didn't have time to talk. This is Father Murphy in the middle. There he is, more respectably dressed. This is Foggy Dew. This purports to be the manuscript that was supplied to me by a relative of thing. But a more recent version of the text demonstration, that we see, this is off the BBC. As we know, BBC is, you know, completely unreliable, full of communists. rebel songs, right, proudly high, you see, over all the time, right. It was England, Bade, or Wild Geese go that small nations might be free, but their lonely graves are by Suvla's waves on the fringe of the great North Sea. God, what's going on here? Precisely, the First World War occurs in the Western Front, and that Suvla must be somewhere near the Western Front. Therefore, the graves must be by the great North Sea. It's a wonderful kind of mix-up for this. Now, what we've seen in Ireland is the most extraordinary of the past 10 years, perhaps even a little bit longer now. It was quite interesting. Some of you will have seen the RTE documentary last week about Gallipoli, entitled Ireland's Forgotten Heroes again. And you begin to worry about this forgotten business, because, my God, we're doing our best to remember them. And it makes for a better title, and Ireland's actually quite well remembered here. nevertheless, there's been this extraordinary and, I mean, commendable, and just unbelievable engagement of independent and nationalist Ireland. I mean, Unionist Ireland was always engaged with the war, at least in a very specific and sort of Ulster Division and Somme sense. But nationalist Ireland never. And now suddenly they've joined the party. If that's what it is, and to the extent that First World War memorials are still being put up in Ireland, which I know are a bit slow off it, but there's one in Killarney in 2009, there's one in Wexford 2013, there's one in New Ross, big one in New Ross, recently, and of course the state visit of Queen Elizabeth in May 2011 added a huge momentum to the incorporation of the First World War into the public history of Ireland and indeed the kind of civic culture of Ireland. Although clearly the hierarchy of events was marked by the choreography of the state visit in which day one the Queen and the President lay wreaths at the Parnell Square Memorial to the revolution and to Irish national achievement of Irish nationhood, as it were, independent nationhood. And day two, they go to the Irish National War Memorial at Island Bridge in Dublin. But the two are done. Now, in 2010, March 2010, President McAleese unveils another brand new monument at the Green Hill Cemetery in the north of Suvla Bay in Gallipoli. And she referred then to a deficit of remembrance, which had afflicted, and she said, and this is an interesting phrase, had afflicted Irishmen who had fought for the British Empire. Now, there's just a sort of distancing, again, of the engagement of Irishmen. And I would just query that slightly. If you look back at what John Redmond was saying in September 1914, the leader, undisputed leader of Nationalist Ireland, he said, our obligation as Irishmen is to fight wherever the firing line extends. In the and he uses these big words, freedom, democracy, freedom of small nations, fighting for a justice and honour, these sorts of things. And these are the big words that politicians use. But it may well be, and if you look at the Irish, the War Memorial, First World War Memorial in Cork, South Mall in Cork, dedicated in St. Patrick's Day in 1925. And what the Cork Memorial says, dedicated to the Munster Fusiliers who fought, it doesn't say they fought, you know, for king and country, as of course many of them do in the north, some in the south actually, but what it says is it's dedicated to those Irishmen who died fighting for the freedom of small nations. And what is that is an assertion of an Irish national engagement with the war. That same in Castle Bellingham is dedicated to the Irishmen who fought in the great war for European freedom, or the great European war for freedom, I think it says. And so it may be that President McAleese is not absolutely right, they were fighting for the British Empire. Although I did notice when President Higgins came on his state reciprocal state visit to London, what he did, and this is a characteristic of state visits to England, is that he lays a wreath at the Tomb of the Unknown Warrior in Westminster Abbey. Now, the Tomb of the Unknown Warrior in Westminster Abbey is dedicated to the dead of the British Empire. It is a specifically imperial memorial, and until the Canadians and Kiwis and the Australians broke ranks and brought their own unknown soldiers back to Ottawa and to Wellington and to Canberra, it was supposed to represent everyone of the whole British Empire. So you can see that. On the other hand, he could have laid a wreath at the cenotaph, which is much less, curiously, as a monument designed by Lutyens, the great imperial architect, is itself a much less imperial monument, and slightly more agnostic about the purposes of the war, certainly not the imperial purposes, or indeed the religious purposes of the war. That's, again, another lecture for another day. But what we've increasingly found, and this characteristic of this moment here in March 2010, is that we're using the commemoration of the war to feed into a kind of reconciliation agenda. That the commemoration of the war is all about peace. It's all about making, reconciling former enmities. Trying to bury these. And that's a very, very strong theme in the commemoration of, particularly of Gallipoli. Because on the Turkish side, the Turkish state can say, this wasn't our war either. This was an imperial war. They fought the Germans, nothing to do with us. As the Australians can say the same sort of thing, and they can meet together and say that, and there's a very, very famous, as those of you who have been to Gallipoli will see this famous statement by Kemal Ataturk, which he made in 1932 or 34, actually speaking to British mothers, but of bereaved mothers, but it's been taken on as if it were addressed to Australians, is that your Johnnies and our Mehmeds are now buried here together, they are at peace. Be reconciled, they're in a friendly land, and it's an extraordinary, moving and important narrative. And something of the same comes out at this moment. Ian Adamson, the chairman of the Psalm Association, explicitly linked the event at Green Hill here to the Northern Ireland peace process. Sons of Ulster, sons of Ireland, he said, do not be anxious. The war is over, both here and in your beloved Ireland. The Western Front is no more. You have to get it mentioned, you see. And Ireland, at last, is at peace with herself and with her people. And that's, of course, very much the predominant theme of war commemoration now. And that's as it should be, and that's important. But it's not the whole historical truth. Because we might go back to Guy Nightingale and his exhilaration in the slaughter of the first couple of days of the Gallipoli campaign. The thing about Nightingale and Geddes and their fellows who survived is they didn't stop. They stayed on for some sense of duty or commitment. They were sustained and propelled Further on through the war, as were so many others, even after the first day of the Somme, to continue fighting, and all sorts of reasons why that should be the case. But it is quite interesting that the costs and the catastrophic engagements of the war does not fundamentally undermine the resilience of many of the soldiers fighting in it. And we need to understand that, as well as the shocking slaughter of this. And one of the importance, and I think one of the great opportunities of the centenary, which this isn't an event, is the focus and the recovery of individual sources and individual narratives. Getting back to, the holy grail for historians is the Leopold von Ranke, the German, who said to tell history as it actually was. V.S. Eisenglich gewesen, I think. It's always good to throw a foreign language phrase in that impresses people. And it's probably wrong, but I'm whizzing along. Never mind. But as it actually was, and that, of course, is the perennial fascination of the war. What would it be like if I were there? Is getting to that. And of course, it's the kind of resources that are in this wonderful treasure house that Ian Montgomery later will introduce us to some of these, is that there's still stuff coming out. We have still things to learn about the war and to understand about it. In a way, if the centenary is of any real value to us, it's not in kind of thinking of it as sort of dead past history, but as a living history, again, which we can engage with and help us understand what activated, what sustained, what influenced those people there in those terrible places. Thank you.
There is John Lee, who's a very well-known military historian, member of the British Commission for Military History and the British Army Records Society. He's been on the council of both of those. He's worked on a number of books over the years. What he's going to speak to us about today is written in Hamilton, was based on Hamilton's own papers that are now housed in the Little Heart Centre for Military Archives at King's College London. One of the most complete collections, I think, of any British general in the First World War, perhaps writing only about regiments that are here. And certainly it was a labour of love to work through those. More recently, he's been working on the Battles of Ypres. He's a book out recently, Gas, on the second Battle of Ypres. And is currently working on a book about essentially one of the four battles of Ypres, I guess, of going through the German spread offensive, five perhaps, just in the last 100 days. So looking at the whole war centred in that very pivotal Belgian city. And with his wife, he's also produced a number of works on the Churchills and the First World War, and is currently working on a piece on Jack Churchill and the First World War of the Army Records Society. So thanks very much for agreeing to talk with us today, John. Very much looking forward to your talk on that. So,
thank you. And I bring you greetings from the Gallipoli Association as well. I'm going to say a bit about the career of Ian Hamilton and to show you what a remarkable general he was, and something about the difficulties he faced in April 1915. If he's sometimes called a hapless general, he had quite a lot to be hapless about, I hope you'll agree. On the 4th of August 1914, Ian Hamilton was 61 years old and had been a serving soldier for 44 years. He was not, as some historians think, a 1914 dugout. He was, in fact, the most senior serving general on the army list. He had many qualities that suited him for independent command at quite high levels, and in many ways was an ideal commander for the Mediterranean Expeditionary Force. He was the son of a colonel of the Gordon Highlanders, always destined for the army. He was actually born on the island of Corfu, where the regiment was in garrison, raised in Scotland. But one of that first intake of Sandhurst cadets who joined after the abolition of the purchase of commissions in 1870. And he first went into the Suffolk Regiment and did a short tour of duty in Ireland before he joined the family regiment in the Gordon Highlanders in India. Now, during long spells when subalterns were sort of grossly underemployed by the army, he indulged his passion for hunting and proved to be a remarkably good shot, and began developing ideas on good shooting and on field craft. Now, unlike many of his contemporaries, he was completely fluent both in French and German. In French because of the voluptuous Henriette, a Swiss maid that raised him as a child, and in German because he spent 6 months in Germany in 1870 just to learn the language. And while he was a subaltern in India, he learned another four languages, because each language you learned was a supplement to your pay as a subaltern. He was a published poet and had written a very perceptive book called The Fighting of the Future in 1885, in which he discussed the importance of accuracy in rifle training. He was tasked by Lord Roberts to improve the rifle training of the army in India, and it did very well. It had great success in that respect. And after experiencing the Turar campaign in 1898, which is important for the lessons it taught in fighting an enemy armed with smokeless powder, made a huge impact on the nature of warfare, he became a natural and very popular commander of the School of Musketry at Hythe in Kent. And there he began a series of badly needed reforms to greatly improve the shooting skills of the British infantry. Now, it has to be said that every commandant of the School of Musketry at Hythe claims to be the man who taught the British Army how to shoot. And, you know, the Germans paid such tribute to that in 1914. But at least we can say that Ian Hamilton started that process of reform and based on his personal experience and the very deep thought he'd given to these issues. He, of course, was not short of combat experience or personal courage. After some skirmishes on the northwest frontier in the late 1870s, his battalion stopped off in South Africa on their way home and took part in the First Boer War. Now, he achieves sort of celebrity status in the Victorian Army because of his personal gallantry at the disastrous Battle of Majuba Hill in 1881. He famously survives a very serious wound to his left wrist. Every picture you see of him, he's got all this claw-like left wrist. And it was, of course, recommended for the Victoria Cross for his personal bravery there. Now, he wasn't awarded the Victoria Cross then because the army decided he was very young and he would have lots of other opportunities to distinguish himself in the army. He was invited by Queen Victoria herself to tell her all about the battle. He could have stayed then and gone to the Staff College in Camberley and become PSC, Past Staff College, but Lord Roberts called him back to India to be his personal ADC. And he then goes back to the army in India and utterly transforms the general musketry skills of the Indian army. He saw service again in the failed attempt to rescue Lord Gordon in the Sudan. Again, he was on his way back to England on some leave and just swung a post with the 1st Battalion, the Gordon Highlanders there. He's the only sort of Indian officer to serve in this African campaign. You probably know that the army then was divided into Lord Roberts's Indian ring, Lord Wolseley's African ring. He's the only officer we know that crosses over that divide. Back in India, he serves in Burma in 1886. He then does the work of the Quartermaster General of India, serving on the pay of the Deputy Quartermaster General, he reminds us. And as I said, after service in the Turar campaign, he comes back to England to work at Hythe after 25 years' service in India. Now, being at Hythe made him ideally placed to be posted to the South African War that just broken out there, the Second Boer War. He goes out on the staff of Sir George White. There he's made the commander of an infantry brigade, and his crucial role in the first great victory of the war over the Boers at Elenslaag in 1899 demonstrates that he's fully grasped modern tactics and the problems posed by magazine rifles firing smokeless powder. The way he trained his soldiers to fight in extreme open order and his personal gallantry in leading the charge at Elenslaag confirms his hero status, as I said, in Victorian society. It also sees him recommended again for the Victoria Cross, because he's literally in the front line leading this brigade of infantry. Here now, the army decides that it doesn't want to encourage brigade commanders to fight in the front line of their troops, so he's denied the Victoria Cross for the second time. He's then involved, of course, in the siege of Ladysmith, and personally leads his troops in repelling the first great Boer assault on the lines at Ladysmith, November 1899. And after that siege is lifted, Lord Roberts immediately calls him back to the main field army and gives him a divisional command. And he is one of the few British generals before 1914 to have commanded more than 20,000 men in the field. He guards Roberts' flank on the road to Pretoria and plays a full part in the several successful battles. There's a lovely account by Sir Horace Smith Dorrien, who served under Hamilton, and he says how much he enjoyed serving under such a delightful leader, always ready to go for the enemy. When Roberts returned to England after his victory, in inverted commas, Hamilton accompanied him back to London, but within a few weeks he's back in South Africa as Lord Kitchener's indispensable chief of staff, and serves there for another 2 years, of course. In that capacity, he was instrumental in running the last Boer commandos to ground and inflicting a very severe defeat upon them at the Battle of Ruwelwaal in April of 1902, which hastens the peace settlement at Vereeniging. Now, between 1902 and 1914, Ian Hamilton serves in all the great offices of the British Army. He's military secretary to the Commander-in-Chief, he's Quartermaster General, Adjutant General, Inspector General of Overseas Forces, and GOC Southern Command. He's a strong advocate of the new territorial force. He's a great fan of volunteer service. He's a strong advocate of closer links between the soldiers and the Royal Navy. He was the official observer on behalf of the Indian Army to the with the Japanese in Manchuria in 1904-1905 during the Russo-Japanese War, and writes some very thought-provoking books about the war there. And he's continually embracing the modern in war, and he decries anything that he sees as outdated elements in training and in doctrine. He's a fierce enemy of mounted cavalry, for instance, and a great advocate of mounted infantry. If he had not been away in Australia and New Zealand on a tour of inspection in 1914, I think he would have been made Chief of the Imperial General Staff. If you remember, the incumbent had to resign after an incident of collective disobedience at the Curra. I'm not allowed to call it the mutiny anymore. But this was a great lost opportunity in a way. Winston Churchill, a very close friend of Ian Hamilton, said he was one of the few generals he knew who thought in army, corps and continents. On that inspection tour in Australia, he marked one brigadier down for special attention in the future because he found him to have an outstanding force of character. And he was referring to the civil engineer John Monash. Now, most significantly, he was GOC Mediterranean based at Malta, where in 1912 he hosted a visit by the First Lord of the Admiralty, Winston Churchill, by Prime Minister Asquith, and by the Consul General of Egypt, Lord Kitchener. They came out to witness a series of amphibious exercises at a time when Britain was about to produce its first manual of combined naval and military operations. That was published in 1913. Hamilton had already done similar work at Malta, at Gibraltar and in Egypt, and he got a good idea of the power of the defence in facing amphibious attacks. He warned specifically about the danger that submarines posed to a fleet attacking a foreign coast. He had his long-term Chief of Staff, Gerald Ellison, with him at that time, and would very much like him to have been at his side in 1915. We'll refer to that later. It is plain to see why in an article in the Journal of the German Great General Staff, the Militar Wochenblatt, in 1914, there was a little pen portrait of Hamilton, and he was described as the single most experienced soldier serving in any army in the world. His range of combat, staff and command experience had few equals. On the outbreak of the war, of course, he was very keen to get in on the fighting. And when his friend Jimmy Grierson, the commander of the 2nd Corps, died, Hamilton immediately offered to step down in a rank so he could take that corps out to France. This was turned down. Sir John French wrote to him and explained that your experience was far too valuable to waste on a corps command, and he expected much greater things for Hamilton. Instead, he was named as GOC of the Central Striking Force. It's a rather ill-defined role in England, but essentially he was there to mobilise the territorial force and, of course, to defend the home islands from any attack. The territorial force promptly doubled itself in size, and it's actually far larger than the British Expeditionary Force in France. And Hamilton personally selects all those territorial battalions that rush over to France to cope with the manpower crisis. Sir John French wrote to him thanking him for that work and said, I look forward to serving with you in the future. In fact, at that time, Lord Kitchener was seriously considering sacking Sir John French and appointing Ian Hamilton in his place as commander of the BEF. Hamilton was hugely familiar with the army, of course, having been a military secretary and adjutant general and a corps commander, and was in very close contact with lots of officers serving on the Western Front, and was rapidly absorbing this feel for the new conditions of warfare and drawing lessons on the power of the defence. In fact, Kitchener had earmarked him to take the second new army out of France. He would have commanded the 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th and 20th divisions in a new army going to France. Some of the most famous divisions in the BEF. And it is one of the great ifs of history if he'd actually gone to France as an army commander. But instead we know that he went to the Dardanelles. Should say that it's fair to say that Kitchener would have appointed someone else. I mean, I think Birdwood, the commander of the Anzacs, would have got the job first, except that the French suddenly came in and offered an army corps under a very senior general indeed, and so Ian Hamilton came in as a more senior general to command in the Eastern Mediterranean. It is also true, of course, that Winston Churchill had been lobbying for Hamilton to get that job, and in fact, from my own research, I know that they were discussing which troops Hamilton might take to Gallipoli a week before Kitchener offered him the job. So there was quite a lot going on there in the background. We know that Hamilton was dispatched with incredible speed and with a wholly inadequate staff thrown together in a couple of days. He was denied his friend Ellison as his chief of staff. He had to take Kitchener's choice, a chap called Walter Braithwaite. He was, of course, given little or no information about his troops or the enemy's troops. He was warned that the 29th Division was only on loan to him and might be taken away from him at any moment. He was denied access to the staff studies that had been made of the Dardanelles. In 1906, we wrote a report, the conclusion of which said, basically, do not attack the Dardanelles from the sea unless you can get 150,000 Greeks to do it for you. And then, of course, he made a perfectly reasonable request for some aircraft to support his operations. Kitchener slammed his fist on the table and said, not one, you know, don't ask me for any more. Winston Churchill, of course, sends out some squadrons of the Royal Navy Air Service. But basically, the whole affair was to be done on the cheap, at a time when Britain could really not afford to mount a second major operation of war. Now, the assembled force, it numbered about 75,000 rifles and supporting troops, was largely untried in current war. I mean, the Royal Naval Division, extremely green organisation, the Australian and New Zealand Army Corps, equally green, had been training in Egypt, thinking they were going to France, ends up at Gallipoli. As I said, even the regular battalions of the 29th Division had only been put together fairly recently and hadn't really bedded down as a division. But then, of course, all these troops are only there to support the Royal Navy. The Royal Navy are going to bash their way through the forts and the minefields, go up and bombard Constantinople. Turkey would surrender. End of story. There was, of course, a Russian army corps was supposed to join the expedition. It wasn't until the 13th of April that Hamilton was told that they would arrive until the middle of June. And, of course, they never arrived at all. Hamilton arrives just in time to see the great naval attack of the 18th of March fail spectacularly. And within days, he had agreed that the army would need to land on the peninsula and clear the area of the Turkish artillery that was covering the minefields and the streets. This is the very definition of mission creep. This is going way beyond what the original intentions were. If I tell you there were 83 heavy guns in the Turkish forts at Gallipoli, and there were 230 field guns covering those forts and the minefields, so it was a very real problem, and you would need troops to do the job. Of course, the MEF had been sent out to the Eastern Mediterranean with no idea of making an amphibious attack at all. They'd been sent there with an eye to saving shipping, and so they weren't even remotely configured for assault landings. Everything had to go back to Egypt, back to Alexandria, unloaded, getting ready for this wholly unprecedented operation of war. To the absolute delight, of course, of the defenders under their German commander, Limon von Sanders, who spent the next 6 weeks digging like mad and improving their defences. Britain has a long history of amphibious warfare, a long history of failure and near disaster. And now this utterly scratched force was going to do something that had never been attempted before in the whole of human history, to assault a number of beaches defended by the modern weapons of war that included magazine rifles, machine guns, quick-firing artillery, trenches and barbed wire. I want to stress this again, because this is important. Neither Ian Hamilton, nor any of his generals, nor any of their staffs, nor any of the naval chiefs, nor any of their staffs had ever done anything like this before in their lives. Their only guide was, as I said, this manual of combined naval and military operations published the year before. And on closer reading, even this doesn't discuss a direct assault on a defended beach. It envisages a silent approach to an enemy coast, something that Britain, with its naval supremacy, could do anywhere in the world. You would then throw ashore a covering force, they will secure a decent bridgehead, then you would introduce your main assault force and you go on and fight the enemy inland. Not a single word in there about assaulting a defended beach. And if you read the orders for the 25th of April landings, you can see that a staff officer has sat down, he's got the manual here, and he's just written out the orders for the assault in exactly the order they appear in the manual. They have nothing else, they have no other experience to go on. In fact, Roger Keyes, the highly competent naval officer, said that the whole thing was done according to some army book and the King's regulations. You know, so much for combined operations, some army book out there. And the other important thing is, this is all done in 33 days. Okay? We spend, what, 2 years planning Normandy? Ian Hamilton and his staff had 33 days to organise this assault that had never been attempted before in history. There's a new book out by Ed Erickson of the United States Marine Corps called Gallipoli Command Under Fire. And he says that this aspect of planning was a most remarkable achievement. And he takes his hat off to Ian Hamilton for getting so much organised in such a short space of time under such extraordinary circumstances. So the miracle of the 25th of April is not that things went badly wrong in so many places. It's that they got ashore at all and established themselves at all. There were many, many anxious people in England who expected and feared the worst. One of them was Sir Charles Caldwell, Director of Military Operations at the War Office, and the author of that 1906 report I told you about that said we shouldn't have even tried it. And he said, soldiers who have examined carefully into the factors likely to govern a disembarkation in force in the face of an enemy who was fully prepared were unanimous in viewing such an operation as a somewhat desperate enterprise. There was no modern precedent for an undertaking of the kind. One dreaded some grave disaster, feared that the troops might entirely fail to gain a footing on shore, and pictured them as driven off after suffering overwhelming losses. And again, rather like Keith, I can now give you another hour lecture on command and control of an amphibious assault landing. You must remember the generals are on warships which are busy bombarding the enemy coast. Fairly distracting for them. The troops are being rowed ashore in open boats by naval ratings. So of course there is every possibility of chaos and confusion. Any soldier or sailor will tell you that an amphibious assault is the most hazardous operation of war, and if something can go wrong, it will go wrong. The Royal Navy of course commands the landings up to the high water mark. Now this is true, it was true then, it's true all through the Second World War, it's true now. If you do an amphibious assault, the Navy is in control of the landings. So when you get this famous incident of the landings at Y Beach, just up here a ways, two battalions go ashore unopposed. Hamilton sees this from off the coast and says, can we get more troops ashore there? The Royal Navy turn around and say, no, you cannot interfere with the landing programme. And so this famous incident where Hamilton is usually blamed for not having enough grip on his troops is entirely a decision by the Royal Navy in accordance with the doctrine that they have available to them. Hamilton's severest critics, of course, suggest that he should have argued against the attempt in the first place, or at least made clear the terrible difficulties they were in for from the start. I say that's asking an awful lot from a professional soldier in an army that was routinely given near impossible tasks by a very parsimonious government, and they're usually just told to get on with it. Hamilton knew that Lord Kitchener, he knew him better than most, would frown upon any request for additional forces to carry this job out. Far from indulging in the sort of luxurious ship-based surroundings of some of the naval staffs, Hamilton set up his general headquarters on the island of Imbros and ran it in truly Spartan conditions. Meals served there were from the same rations received by the troops in the front line. In fact, Hamilton actually gloried in going down with a dose of dysentery as it was raging away through its forces. Any accusation of remoteness towards Ian Hamilton can be countered by the post-war recollections of a veteran of the 42nd East Lancashire Territorial Division. This chap said, I've served in three theatres of war under five different commanders in chief, and the only one I ever met in a frontline fire trench was Sir Ian Hamilton at Cape Helles. From the evidence in his wife's diaries, Jean Hamilton's diaries, we know that Hamilton did not underestimate the Turkish enemy in quite the way that Kitchener seems to have done. Once ashore, Hamilton was under constant pressure from London to achieve something, but he was never given the men, and more importantly, the guns and ammunition needed to defeat the enemy land forces. Again, Churchill very perceptively said that Ian Hamilton faced the entire Turkish army in relays, while he, of course, was being drip-fed reinforcements that arrived either too little or too late. The peak strength of the Mediterranean Expeditionary Force at any time was about 188,000 men. Now, if I tell you that at that time the Turks could bring 250,000 men onto the peninsula to oppose them, you'll see that this is a truly desperate undertaking. Remember, the attacker is supposed to be three times stronger than the defender, and here you've got 188,000 men being blocked by 250,000 men. Hamilton and his staff officers knew how desperately short of absolutely everything the War Office in London was, and although their demands on London were much more vigorous than they're normally given credit for, they knew that there was just very little to go around. Instead, Hamilton began to formulate a new theory on war that recognised the power of the defence. Having inflicted a series of crushing defeats on really large-scale Turkish counterattacks, where the Turkish dead quite literally laid in heaps in front of our trenches and the losses of the defenders were absolutely minuscule, Hamilton writes up in July a description of how to attack and seize a Turkish position that the Turks would be desperate to recapture, and then you more or less invite them to counterattack and you then proceed to massacre their infantry. Those of you familiar with the Western Front will recognise that as the classic bite and hold operation that the BEF groped its way towards in 1916 and made an absolute standard operational procedure by 1917. The Turks, I mean entirely understandably, had a policy of attacking to drive us back into the sea, and as I said, this leads to the massacre of their infantry on several occasions. If I tell you that on the Western Front, two Allied soldiers died for every German soldier killed, and on the Gallipoli Peninsula, that's exactly reversed, and two Turkish soldiers die for every Allied fatality. This is the harsh measure that we have to accept during attritional warfare. Now, I certainly don't want to take anything away from the Turkish army and its famous victory at Gallipoli. We certainly did underestimate them before we attacked, but again, this book by Ed Erickson, which I warmly recommend to you, reminds us that we are facing a thoroughly trained army in the German model, tactically very adept, and of course fighting on its home turf. Here's one example. In the whole of Great Britain, there were just 447 officers who were PSC, past Staff College, Camberley Staff trained. At that same time, the Turkish army had 4,000 staff officers who'd been trained in the German model, up to a level of German efficiency. The Turkish army was fighting to defend its hearth and its home, displaying a superb level of situational awareness that which frustrated every attack we ever made. The truth is that we were outfought on the Gallipoli Peninsula by a better prepared army for fighting on that peninsula. The demands from London are wholly unreasonable. They never gave the proper backing to a campaign from which they expected so much. In a way, they created an impossible dilemma for themselves. The expanding war on the Western Front was consuming munitions and material at a rate that could never have been predicted before 1914. We were asking the men at Gallipoli to break trench lines with anything like the amount of guns and shells necessary to do the job. When they finally decide to send a massive reinforcement out in mid-1915, they send out wholly untried divisions with even more untried commanders, with outdated guns. And this I always found astonishing. They send out two entire divisions of Territorial Force infantry with not one single piece of artillery amongst them, not one gun. This is cannon fodder in the literal sense of the term. So, yes, the local commanders can be criticised at all kinds of levels. And, you know, I do criticise Hamilton for a certain lack of grip on some situations, but I reserve my strongest criticism for the political leaders and their military advisers based in London, asking for a decisive victory and demanding it be achieved with little more than the failed bodies of our soldiers. And the authorities in London also deserve a little consideration. They've been taken in by the biggest mission creep in recorded military history. From a naval squadron bombarding an enemy coast via a hazardous amphibious assault, which was unplanned for and unexpected, into another trench deadlock campaign that sucked in men, guns, ammunition, and more seriously, sucked in shipping at a rate that we could not really sustain. As I said, in 1915, before our industry and our manpower are fully mobilised, we can really only afford one major campaign overseas, not two. If I tell you that it took six times more ships to maintain the MEF on the peninsula than it took to supply the whole of the BEF in France and Flanders. The line of communication, of course, 3,000 miles long, is 60 times longer than that feeding the Western Front. In 1915, it takes 262 ships to carry something like 330,000 men to Gallipoli. In 1918, it takes just 26 ferry boats to carry 900,000 men across the Channel to France. So you see the strain on our logistics supporting this campaign. It is quite phenomenal. And it is the demands of the war in other theatres, not just the Western Front, but spreading war in the Balkans, that sees the politicians in London wash their hands of the whole business. They first recall Hamilton, and then, of course, shut down the campaign completely. Between the wars, it would be seen as one of the great lost opportunities to knock out one of Germany's allies at less cost than fighting the Germans in France and Flanders. I used to share that idea once, and I'm sorry to say that I long since abandoned that illusion. We are left with a wonderful tradition of service and sacrifice by a truly allied coalition that tied down almost the whole of the Turkish army for most of 1915. And remember, we're talking about British, Australians, New Zealanders, the Indians. There's a very important contribution made by the Indian Army here. Even the Newfoundland Regiment pops up later on. The French, of course, reference we made to, of course, 10,000 French soldiers die in Gallipoli. 8,700 Australians die in Gallipoli. I love telling young Australians that. It comes as a shock to them. Actually, nowadays, it comes as a shock to the French as well. Most French have no idea they were anywhere involved. For the Anzacs, it very quickly assumes this mystical force in their national history. Even in 1916, it's being hailed as the birth of these two nations, Australia and New Zealand. Some Australian soldiers in London wrote to Ian Hamilton, whom they absolutely adored. They frankly admired him. They wrote to him in April of 1916 saying, "The day draws near that marks Australia's first birthday. With you on the 20th of April last year, we laid firmly the foundations of our military history," capital M, capital H. "And in a few days, we hope to celebrate a glorious anniversary." When the Australian government proposed a medal for their soldiers who had served at Gallipoli, to the undying credit of those diggers, they refused to accept it unless it went also to their British and Indian comrades in arms at the same time. Now, that didn't happen, of course. You know that Britain doesn't issue medals for defeats, so there was no Gallipoli medal. The Australians do eventually get their separate Gallipoli medal, and the soldiers involved in the fighting from April up to about the early part of May are allowed to apply for the 1914-15 star. We obviously can't discuss any of the fighting in detail here, happy to take questions on that, but it's important to remember the wholly inadequate nature of the supply of artillery and ammunition in a war where these factors assume a decisive role. I've already told you about Suvla being sent, troops being sent out with no artillery at all. One small example, a lovely little New Zealand write to Ian Hamilton saying, "We've got a battery of 4.5 inch howitzers we can let you have. That will be really useful on the peninsula. But we haven't got any ammunition for it, and we can't send you any horses either." So Ian Hamilton has to write back to New Zealand saying, "Thank you very much for the offer, but that would just deplete my small stocks of ammunition already," and he has to turn down this kind of help. And this is the general sort of problem that he has to cope with all through the campaign. We know he's denied the general specifically asked for by name for the August offensive. Some of those would then be supplied from France after it's all gone horribly wrong at Suvla Bay. But my military history doesn't go around looking for generals to blame for things going wrong, but it has to be said that the collection of generals serving in 9th Corps at Suvla Bay were a most remarkable collection of individuals. They're leading very keen kitchen and volunteer divisions. And I say I can only grieve at the intolerable demands being placed on some of these generals. They were completely and utterly out of their depth in terms of age, of physical, and even of mental fitness. I mean, again, some of you may know that General Hammersley, commander of the 11th Division, had in 1912 been in a lunatic asylum, literally in a straitjacket because of his mental health problems. He's declared fit and comes out in command of an infantry division. One of Hammersley's staff officers wrote about Hammersley, "I thought it was a wicked thing ever to have sent him out there." And again, this is laid at the door of London, of course, and not at anybody in the peninsula. Just to wrap the story up, Ian Hamilton is recalled, of course, in October of 1915. Many lobbied for his retention in the service, that he'd be given a new active command, but the Dardanelles Commission kept him entirely busy through to the end of the war. After the war, he's instrumental in pulling together the many various and sometimes antagonistic veteran organisations, brings them all together under the umbrella of the British Legion, and then, and typically Hamilton's style, steps back and lets Douglas Haig take all the credit for that work. He was in constant demand to address reunion dinners and societies, and he said that he opened a new local war memorial every 2 weeks for 2 years. That's how popular he was back in England, and how highly he was thought of. He does continue his very deep study of warfare and produces very important theoretical works that demonstrated his truly modern grasp of war. He advocated large-scale mechanisation of the army, of course. He advocated the unified tri-service staff college and even a unified tri-service cadet school. He actually invents air-portable divisions in 1920. I mean, in the 1920s, he would have whole divisions that could be moved around by air. My point is that he's always years ahead of his time in the way he thinks about these things. He stands out as the hero of that school that utterly opposed the attritional warfare on the Western Front, and I'm looking for an alternative method of combating the Central Powers. As I said, most military historians now come to see that the First World War could only have been fought in the way it was, by grinding down the main enemy on the main front, the German army on the Western Front. But Hamilton remains this sort of intriguing figure in many ways. You know, how would he have performed in France? How would he have performed as Chief of the Imperial General Staff? I'm going to end with one very short sort of intervention, which I only added after I checked with Keith that he wasn't going to talk about it. And this is the interesting relationship between Sir Ian Hamilton and Sir Brian Mahon, the commander of the 10th Irish Division, a lieutenant general in command of a division. Now, he should have had a corps command, and the division goes to a major general. So there was a question mark over Brian Mahon's career that obviously prevented him being given a corps command. Now, Ian Hamilton has said, because of this intimate knowledge he has of the Army Officer Corps, had made the remark that he was offered Mahon as commander of the 9th Corps at Suvla Bay, and he wrote back and said, "I don't think he'll be suitable, because when I saw him in action in South Africa, I saw him get on his high horse over a question of seniority, and he actually refused to take a part in a combat operation. This is a man who thought more of his personal status and his rank over the actual requirements of an operation." And of course, and Ian Hamilton specifically warned London that this is the sort of thing that might happen if he came to Gallipoli. And guess what? That's exactly what happened. At Suvla Bay, he was asked to serve under Beaver de Lisle and refused and went off in a huff, actually resigned his command in the middle of an active operation, which is an extraordinary thing for a First World War general to do. So I just thought I'd bring that in as a little Irish connection to this talk, and look forward to hearing your questions. Thank you very much.